node and a clinician or the surgeon is not able to find where the primary is, obviously, as per our current teaching, we should do a cross-sectional imaging, which is usually a CT or an MR, which is reasonably good. But what last 10 years have taught us is PET CT in about 15 to 20% cases will detect a primary if a CT scan or an MRI is normal. So those, that 15 to 20% is a sizable number. So it does have an incremental value over the presently widely available cross-sectional imaging techniques like CT, which is there almost in every city, every district place. Now, talking about whether PET CT can make a clinical impact in terms of, as Sarbani said, planning the treatment, in making, giving an optimal treatment plan, yes, it does, because it will tell you where the primary is, it will tell you what is the exact extent of the local and regional disease. And in such a case where you have a bulky node, it can also pick up distant metastases, which a CT scan usually won't. CT scan is a local imaging technique which doesn't scan the entire body. PET CT scans the entire body. So your treatment plan can entirely change. And we know that outcomes are based on giving ideal treatment. So there is no current evidence to say that PET CT can change outcomes. But if you extrapolate that, if you're giving correct treatment, it will lead to better outcomes, and you can extrapolate that logic and say that, yeah, it does have an impact to change outcomes, though there is no evidence to suggest so.
So let's go to the treatment planning. So I want to know, why would you, how would you all actually sit and discuss? Now, me as a surgeon would like to operate this.
So...
Now, so, having said all that about evidence based and all, I'm a surgeon, right? So I'm going to going to pitch in for surgery, Dr. Ofo.
So, as you made a good point about chemoradiotherapy therapy as a standard of care, and I'd like to be a little bit controversial and say it's not actually a gold standard, because there's never been a head-to-head comparing chemoradiotherapy versus surgery and adjuvant therapy in the management of oropharyngeal cancer. So we cannot say that it is the gold standard, but it has become a standard of care, because as radiotherapy techniques have evolved, we have found that the historical open surgical techniques did not offer a significant survival advantage over chemoradiotherapy, but instead there was significant morbidity as well. So I tend to say, when I sit in the MDT, I say that you have options. Now, in the context of this particular patient, my concern would be that with the degree of extracapsular spread that is already evident on imaging, this patient is going to need to have adjuvant radiotherapy. They may even need to have chemoradiotherapy. So you already have two modalities of treatment that this patient is going to be exposed to. To then add the additional morbidity of surgery, with all its functional impairment, both in terms of swallowing function, shoulder dysfunction, because the accessory nerve, I don't know if you're going to cover it, but
that's going to go.
The accessory nerve is going to go. I would be very reluctant to offer this patient surgery. However, because they're HPV negative, that adds another context.
In India,
because we know that HPV negative patients, they have the worst outcomes. So you could be arguing that in those patients, I don't know what it is in India, but in the UK, I could be arguing that trimodality treatment might be, so being more radical, me being more aggressive, is an option for this patient, because if they recur, then the probability of salvaging them is low. So that would be the discussions in our MDT.
Right. So it's the twist again in the tail. Dr. Chowker.
Yeah, so what is being discussed is going back a little bit to the investigations. As Dr. Sharma said, there's something that is optimum. So PET CT is the gold standard. But if you don't have a PET CT, don't say you can't treat the patient. Do what best you have. Do a CT scan. Try to find the primary. If you don't, look at the clinical picture. See where the disease is coming from. Level 2 will usually come from the oropharynx. If it's EBV negative, it's unlikely to be nasopharynx. So you can treat the patient. You don't have to refer it out to a center which has a PET CT, unless there are some strong indications. So that's number one. Number two, the treatment of oncology in cancer surgery or cancer treatment there are three modalities, as you all know: surgery, chemotherapy, and radiotherapy. It's the interplay between these two. And how do you decide which treatment is best? And that came out in the discussion that you will try to balance outcome versus functional morbidity that you give the patient. So if you have a location of the disease that is going to be functionally morbid if you operate the patient, versus you have a similar outcome using chemo radiation therapy and try to preserve the organ, you will go for the lesser morbid treatment and try to get the same outcome by preserving the function of the individual. So that's how we'll discuss in the DMG. I will talk to Sarbani, what are the chances that she will be able to cure Kumar chemo radiation therapy. I, as a surgeon, me and Prathamesh will see what is the functional morbidity if you operate this patient. And then we'll come to a consensual consensus whether to offer the patient chemo radiation or do surgery followed by adjuvant treatment. So these are the modalities that you need to play around, keeping in mind function versus outcome.
Sarbani.
I think Devendra brought a very good point that, Oppo, if we have to plan surgery on him, since it's a midline tumor, the surgery would require bilateral neck dissection. And then invariably, we'll end up doing a supraglottic laryngectomy because it is just there in the pharyngoepiglottic fold. So the part of the epiglottis will go. So he will have a epiglottis which is gone, bilateral neck dissection which has been done, and then certainly he requires chemo radiotherapy. And we know that supraglottic laryngectomy, bilateral neck dissection, followed by, you know, concurrent chemo radiotherapy, the quality of life of this patient will be really bad after surgery.
So one more word has come up, quality of life. Okay, so Sarbani, we are coming from evidence-based practice to quality of life. So Sarbani, how will you ensure that he has a good quality of life with your chemo radiation?
So as everybody has discussed, I guess the options of treatment are surgery followed by adjuvant CTRT or CTRT. So upfront CTRT and reserving surgery for salvage in the event that you have a residual lymph node left. So this again brings into point another aspect of the PET CT. If we had a baseline PET CT, that PET CT can also be used to actually monitor response in this patient post-therapy. So the PET does not just serve as a diagnostic modality, but it is also going to be used to actually monitor response to treatment, and that also has a bearing on the ultimate prognosis on the patient. So that's one thing. The next thing is whether, if we are going to treat with CTRT today, how do we ensure that the patient has a reasonable quality of life? Keep in mind that whatever oncologic treatment you were to give this patient, there would be some amount of morbidity associated. Pankaj has talked about the surgical morbidity. Now, as far as radiotherapy goes, when I treat this patient, or when anybody in radiation oncology for head neck would treat this patient, the volumes would essentially encompass the primary. So this primary that is lighting up there, which is kind of in the base tongue valicular kind of area, just going into the laryngeal surface of the epiglottis. So we would take that as the gross disease. We call that the gross tumor. Then you've got these lymph nodes. So the lymph node levels will also be included depending upon the involvement. And today, with the technology that we have at our disposal, we can give different doses to different areas of the lymph nodes depending upon whether they're involved, not involved, or what is the likelihood that they may harbor microscopic disease. So what happens is that we can give a very high dose to the areas that light up strongly on the PET CT, give lower doses to the adjacent uninvolved areas, and in doing so also protect adjacent critical structures. Like in this particular section, what you can see in addition to the lymph node are the submandibular glands on both sides. You don't see the parotids at this level because this is much lower than that. But because of this evolution in planning, we can actually save these adjacent mucosa. The opposite area would also get some radiotherapy, but this dose would be much lower than the dose that we would deliver here. The other important structures that we have to keep in mind are the swallowing apparatus, that is the constrictors of the pharynx, which again control for swallowing. And of course, if you go higher up, there are various structures that are associated with the swallowing mechanism. We can, to some extent, try to protect, but that would not be the primary goal. The primary goal would be to give tumoricidal doses to the involved areas, that is the highest dose possible, then try to reduce the doses to important neurological structures like the spinal cord, the brain stem, then reduce doses to other important structures like the parotids, the submandibular glands, the pharyngeal constrictors, so that we can avoid the consequential morbidity of radiotherapy like aspiration, like xerostomia, and then that we have what we have because of xerostomia, dental caries, or difficulty, an intolerance to spicy food, which is so important in the Indian context, you can understand, and things like that. So that is how we would tailor our radiotherapy today because of the technical, technological evolution that we have. Now, that is not to say that if you don't have advanced machines, you can't treat this patient well. You can still treat this patient adequately, but what we would have to do is that the morbidity of treatment would be much higher because there would be no way to kind of give a lower dose here. You would give the same dose, but maybe as you proceed through treatment, reduce the volumes of radiotherapy. Sorry.
So we've seen how such a seemingly easy case gets discussed out with all its broad implications, coming down to what's best for the patient in front of you. Do you all have any questions to ask? Yeah, please go ahead. We can hear you. Go ahead. Go ahead.
Good morning, sir. Sir, I would like to ask that PET CT is considered to be costlier than CCT, I guess.
Yeah.
So, in case of if there is a rural area and you go to hospital or any other center where there is PET CT not available, So, if there is CCT, what would you do if you have both PET CT and CCT in case of? Actually, I want to ask that PET CT is more costlier now. And
so which would you select?
Which would you select?
I think if you have a